Welcome back to another Talk Let's Conversation. I wish that we lived in a world where everyone was truly happy, not this fake happiness, because that's where people start having mental health issues, when they start faking it until they make it. That's pretty tough to do. I mean, fake it till you make it. If you're not happy, you're not happy. You need to resolve those issues in your life that you're not happy in so you can be happy. But when you go around faking it, all that does is pushes you further and further back into a darkness, if you will, into a depression in some sense. So I just would love to see you wake up every morning and you being on point. I mean, I know life is not perfect, but each moment you have, each moment that you breathe, you should enjoy it. Some of you are waiting for your vacation to enjoy your life. That's too late. You might not get there. Some of you are waiting till you retire. That's way off. You sure might not get there. And so I would provoke you that each morning you wake up and you have breath in your body, you should enjoy your life. You should be inspired to be up. You should be thankful and grateful that God opened up your eyes and let you see another day. That's what we should be, all of us. Stop hanging around an environment that's negative, an environment that pulls away your good energy, your positive energy, and pushes in you, its negative energy. That's what's happening. I mean, you look at social media, and I don't mean to put social media down. When you look at the World Wide Web, I mean, when you look at news, TV, just any kind of news at all, everything is selling fear. Everything is selling negative energy. And so that's where we are. Now, you don't have to be there just because the world is there. You have an opportunity to be an individual. You know, everybody wants to be different. So why don't you be different? Why don't you take a stance and you fight for your happiness? You fight for your joy. You fight for your peace. How many of you have made this statement? And you made it to someone because someone has said something. You said, if you say that one more time, you're going to make me scream. I mean, you've heard that, right? I just heard that last week. As Christians, let me tell you something. I'm sick and tired of you making this particular statement. Now, I'm not going to scream. I just want to get you straight. But we're making a statement because this world is so bad. I mean, come on. We all know it's messed up. I mean, it's worse than Sodom and Gomorrah. And so some of you are making this statement. I wish God would come back like right now. And I listen to you, and I just want to tell you, I think that's selfish. You see, because you are a believer, because you're giving your life to Jesus Christ, you don't think anyone else should have an opportunity when you make that statement. Because there are so many people still lost out here. I mean, just look at your family alone. I mean, in your family, you've got a lot of work to do. There's a lot of individuals who haven't accepted Christ as their Savior. And I think you want them saved. I hope you want them saved. So stop saying that. Now, hold up. Now, if you want God to come and get you, then that's another whole conversation. I mean, then let's pray that He come and get you. See, you don't want that. No, you're not ready to just leave. You want everyone to leave and you leave with them. But God is not ready for everyone. Everyone's not ready for God. Let's put it that way. The Lord tells us in the book of Timothy that He desires that all would be saved. Now, if He desires everyone to be saved, I mean, what are you praying for? What are you praying against? I mean, just enjoy the life that you have. I know it's tough out here. I know you don't like to see what you see, but it's here in front of us. So my thing is to pray, to witness, to testify, to speak life into someone who's not doing quite as well as you are. 2 weeks ago, we had this eclipse, and darkness was over a certain region for about 3 to 4 minutes. I mean, just total darkness. And I thought I'd play a prank on my wife and my daughter. They both went back in the house before it got pitch dark, and my wife was getting some refreshments. My daughter, I'm not sure what she was doing, but she went back in. And so I decided to take off my hat and take off my my solar shades, if you will, and just put them on the porch where I was sitting at. And so when they come back out, they think I was raptured up, you know, think I was caught up and gone with the Lord. But I didn't pull it off. I didn't do it the right way, because when I think about it, I should have had a sweatsuit on. I mean, if I, you know, thinking now after the fact, had my hat on, I should have pulled everything off and left it right there and then have my camera sitting back and just watching their response. But I didn't do that. I didn't think I wanted to shock them like that. But that's what's going to happen. I mean, you heard the story in the Bible where there will be two in the field. And one will be caught up, raptured up, as we call it. There will be two at the meal, grinding away, working. And one will be caught up. One will just be left there. That's what's going to happen. See, that's where we are right now. When you look at darkness, this eclipse came for a moment. Darkness is going to come just like that. So as we talk about the last days, we talk about the end times. And some of us are going to be shocked. You know how you're driving at night and it's dark, and you know how you've been up all day and you're tired and you fall asleep behind the wheel, and you wake up and you know you're like shocked that whew, what could have happened. And so now you're out awake for like a month. I mean, you know, you want to close your eyes. I mean, that will spark a thought in you of how fast things can take place, how fast you can be up and out of here. So each day you need to start enjoying. Stop letting people push their agenda on you. Yeah, you've got an agenda. It's in the Word of God. You don't need someone else's agenda. Your job is to be prosperous and in good health. Your job is to be pleasing to the Lord. That's what your job is. That's what all of our jobs are. Go with me to the book of Revelation, chapter 16, verse 15. This particular verse, and this is all we have, is this one verse. But this particular verse is in the book of Revelation. Now, theologians have said this should have been in the book of Genesis. Like, Lord, why did you put this way in the back, in the middle of the book of Revelation, when the Bible is about to close, you know, the end times? Why do you put this at the beginning? Let me tell you something. I truly believe that God knows exactly what he's doing and where he's placing things. And we can question him all we want to, but we know he's right, because he's always right. The book of Revelation, chapter 16, verse 15 reads like this. Behold, this is Jesus talking. I am coming like a thief, like a thief. Blessed is the one who stays awake, keeping on his garments, that he may not go about naked and be seen exposed. You're asking yourself the question, why did God refer to himself coming back like a thief? I mean, that's what I thought. I mean, why would you use that one, a thief? I mean, you could have used anything but a thief. Let me tell you why. Because most of you can relate to a thief. Because most of you have stole something. You shoplifted something. You've taken something that wasn't yours. And so that's why God is using this thief as an example. I mean, think about this. The world can relate, can identify more with the thief on that cross, the thief itself, than it can with the Savior. Now, that should make you think for a moment. I mean, let that sink in. Just stay right there for a moment. The world relates closer. The world is in line more with a thief than it is with the Savior. Can I say it again? The world we live in, and some of you listen to me right now, you're more in alignment. You're more calibrated with the thief, with the characteristic of a thief, than you are with your Lord and Savior, with your Creator. Behold. Behold is simply saying, let me get your attention. Will you pay attention? Because this is very important. Behold. And then Jesus says, I am coming. He says, it's been prophesied. I'm on my way. Some of you are trying to rush me, but I'm coming. I'm returning. Just hold your horses. He says, but I'm coming like a thief. Not as a thief. No. I'm coming like something that you're used to hanging around, something that you're familiar with. Because you're not familiar with me, but you're familiar with the thief, because you've got some thievery inside of you. And so I'm talking to you in your vernacular. I want to talk to you on your level. when we look at a thief and how it's defined, it's very simple. A thief is someone that steals. How much time have you stolen from your life? How much time have you allowed to be stolen from your life? A thief will case at your house for months. I mean, if not years. A thief is trying to see exactly who's his or her next victim. And so they will case out anything that they think has value to it. That's why you see men casing out women, and you see women casing out men. I mean, just casing out, you know, looking to see what's going to make you vulnerable so I can take advantage of you. That's what a thief wants. A thief wants to know, are you comfortable in your neighborhood to where you can start leaving your doors open? Are you comfortable in your life where you can start leaving your heart open? That's what a thief comes to do. A thief is just, yeah, clever. You see these guys riding by your house sometimes, just riding real slow. Yeah, they're looking to see who's vulnerable. They're looking to see if they can find an angle to get in. Sometimes they have a young lady get out and she'll come twist the doorknob at your house and you open the door and she says, oh, I must be at the wrong house. And she looked back at the car to her husband and said, honey, this is not it. This is the wrong house. She knows it's the wrong house. She was trying to see how vulnerable you've become, how lackadaisy you become. Because guess what? You don't pray anymore. You don't fast anymore. No. See, life has stolen that from you. The devil has taken that from you. He's occupied it with other stuff. And so the thief is just looking at you. He's just looking at your schedule because you're not praying. No. God is so good, though. He gives us signs. Wow. That person twisting their doorknob, that's a sign. Hey, you're slipping in some areas. They think you're vulnerable. They're testing you out. I told you, riding by your house, they're testing you out. You see, are you still on point? Or have you gotten lackadaisy? Because we do. Once we feel like we're just kind of in a comfortable neighborhood, you know, or we're in a comfortable position in life, we become lackadaisy. We become lackluster, if you will. You see some young man walking by your house. You know how that makes you feel. Like, well, what is he up to? So you're leaving your house in your car. You'll drive around the street and come back to see what he's up to. Did he mess with your house? I mean, see, that's when you're watching the signs around you. Some of you just pull out and just keep on going because you have no thought of what's about to happen because you become so comfortable. You just start dating anyone. It doesn't matter. You think you got it together. I'm just going out and just using him to get a meal. No. Be careful. You don't know how vulnerable you are until something happens. You don't know how clever the thief is until you're taken advantage of. And that's where we are. We're told that man should always pray. See, if you pray, it's like your security system being on. You know, you go out and get the most powerful security system. You got cameras on the outside, cameras on the inside. You got a ring. I mean, you got all these things, burglar bars in your house. You got all this stuff. And that's what the Word of God is. It tells us to pray without ceasing. Man, it tells us men must always pray. Because God sees you as a protector, a provisionary. God sees you as responsible for you and your family. And so if you stop praying, whoa. I mean the guards, the curtain come down. And a thief can see this. He knows when you're weak. He can see it, the way you carry yourself, the times you come home at night. Yeah, coming home at 2 a.m. No. You got a family inside the house by themselves. See, he can see all that stuff. Satan is so clever, but he's watching you. He's always watching you. He's trying to see when you're going to faint, when you're going to let your guard down, when you're going to lower your guard. When your wife can pray more than you, when your wife know more word than you, you're fainting. You're letting your guard down. I understand she reads just as much as you do, but I'm sorry. You should be pushing in, not to compete with her, to compliment her. But you have more women who know more word than their husband. That's because men, we think we're little g. We think we're a little God in some sense. We got big egos. And we think the church, I mean, the church is okay, but that's really not for me. I mean, I'm okay. No, you're not okay. You've allowed the devil to come in and steal the gift of the word of God that's inside of you. The responsibility he's put on you. Well, Donnie, I'll take care of my family. I understand. That's one point. You work. I get it. You work hard. But you should work harder in the word of God. You should dig deep to find your security system. You don't have to put up cameras all around your house when you got cameras all inside of you. The word of God is exposing you. Yeah, it shines out, boy. He got his stuff together. Everyone can see it. You're walking around vulnerable. You're allowing your family to be a victim if you're not careful. John 10 and 10 says it like this, that a thief comes to steal and to kill and to destroy. Now just hold on to it for a moment. That's what a thief comes to do. Oh, he just want to steal somebody. No. He comes to kill, steal, and destroy. You don't know which one he's going to pick up on just based on what he needs to do that day. You don't want him around, is what I'm trying to say. You don't want to be in that environment. You don't want to be that weak. You don't want your family being a victim. Jesus says, I am come that they might have life and that they might have it, watch this, more abundantly. Now, here we go. I told you, quit talking about you wish Jesus come back right now. There are so many people who need this life and need an abundance of it. Because Satan is busy. I mean, he's here, I know, and you're tired of him because he is stealing, killing, and destroying stuff all around you. He's got everything perverted. I get it. I'm living with this whole environment just like you. But I'm praying also that God will save my siblings and my cousins and my family and my friends and all my loved ones, everyone I've worked with. I'm praying that God will save ministers. Yeah, save them. Yeah, I know they're ministers, but still save them. Bring them back to the fold. I'm praying for pastors and evangelists because let's be for real. This world is so polluted that everything around it becomes diluted. I don't care who you are. I don't care what bishop you are, apostle you are. If you live in this world, you can be tainted. You can be diluted because there's just so much stuff being poured into us. We've allowed the devil to get the upper hand on this earthly realm. And he's got so much streaming at us. I can't even look at social media too much anymore. It's too much junk dancing around, butt naked, you know, cussing, fussing. It's just too much. It's hard to watch TV now. TV is soft porn now. I don't care how you look at it. It is. Everything we look at is just bad. And so you have to push so much word in you to find the good in you. Then Jesus tells us in the B clause of the book of Revelation, chapter 16, verse 15, he says, blessed is the one who stays awake. Not the one who's awake. I mean, that's good too, but the one who stays awake. Because let's be for real. Some of us are going to backslide. Some of us are awake, but we're going to give in. So Jesus says, blessed is the one who stays awake, which means being saved. That's what that means. You can't be awake if you're not saved. You're just as asleep as you want to. I mean, you've dozed off at the wheel, driving down the highway. You've dozed off. So you're not awake. Blessed is the one who stays awake. Your fleshly desires dims your physical eyesight. That's what that does. That infects your spiritual insight. See, that's why you doze off at the wheel. Because you have an infection inside of you. It's called sin. And you keep sinning because you won't give your life to Jesus Christ. And so your eyes are dim. You really can't. You can't see what I can see. Not with my spiritual eyes. You can't see. That's why this warning is embedded in the book of Revelation. It's embedded way in the middle of the book of Revelation. I mean, the Bible's about to end. But here comes this warning. And the Lord is saying, behold, he says, pay attention. I got some good news for you. I got something for you. See, we talk about being woke, you know, using that word, kind of like a cultural slang word. But really, awoke just simply means, watch this. This just simply means be aware. Be sober. Be ready. Don't be trying to get ready. Be ready. I mean, go and get ready. Don't get me wrong. You got to work on it. But you need to be ready. When Jesus comes, when he comes snatching people up out of here, you need to be ready. You can't be getting on your knees trying to pray, Father, forgive me. Watch this. No. I mean, in Thessalonians, what does it say? But you are not in darkness, brothers. believers is talking to. But that day, to surprise you, like a thief. See, no, don't be trying. You need to be ready. A thief breaks in. You need to be ready. I know some of you are ready. You went and bought all these guns. Some of you just waiting for, matter of fact, you left your door open, some of you, for him to come in. You really ready? No, I'm not talking about y'all. That's a whole different conversation. There's a story about a teacher who gave her class a 21-question pop quiz. She told them to read the instructions before taking the test and then take the test. And when they finished, they could leave the classroom. Now, she did something she'd never done before. She left the classroom. So everyone's looking around like, whoa, she don't care if we cheat and to get our books out and start cheating on this pop quiz. And no, she's gone. She gave instructions. See, our problem is we don't follow instructions. Or we like giving them, but we don't follow them. And so a few students who listen and follow instructions, they read the whole test. They signed their name on the test. They turned it in on her desk in the tray, and they left the classroom. Now, they did this within probably 45 seconds, no more than a minute. Everyone else is sitting in the classroom struggling, like, whoa, how did they finish so fast? Why did they zip through this thing so fast? Watch this. Some people stayed there for 30 minutes. Some people stayed there for an hour, figuring out how to finish this test, go through all those 21 questions, trying to get them right because it's a pop quiz. And at the end of the test, if you had read through like the teacher told you, at the end of the test, it says, get up, sign your name on the paper, and put it in my tray. You've completed the test. You see, they read through the instructions like the teacher told them. We have a Bible in front of us with instructions on how to finish this race, how to finish our test in life. But we refuse to read it. We refuse to let it absorb it inside of us and let it really take out all the impurities that's inside of us. We refuse to follow the word of God. You see, that's why most of you have become victims before. Because you take things for granted. You don't want to read the instructions. You don't want to follow the instructions. You don't want to be attentive in class. You're not an active listener, they would say. So when it comes to your life, and you're talking about your life, which is so valuable, and talking about the quality of your life and how much your life is worth, I think it's worth you paying attention to the Word of God. I think it's worth you digging in and getting into the details so that you can live a good quality life versus the kind of life you're living right now, a life as a victim. So now we're at a point where I call the C clause of this particular chapter and verse. Behold, I'm coming like a thief. Blessed is the one who stays awake. Here comes the C clause, keeping his garments on. Now, if you read the Bible before, you know anything about the Bible, you know that most garments are considered garments of like a bright color, if you will, white linen, which represents righteousness, represents dignity, represents praise and strength. That's what it represents. But if you look at the book of Ephesians, chapter 6, verse 11 through 18, I'm just going to run through this real fast. It says, put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Stay awake. That's what it's saying. Don't fall asleep. Don't become a dead man walking. That's what that's saying. Then verse 12. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Just going to get that piece. How many times can you read this and not believe this? For we wrestle not against flesh and blood. You fight your flesh and blood every single day. Let me see. How many times can you read this, can you hear this, and not believe this? You're fighting in a spiritual battle. It's not flesh and blood. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil days, and having done all, to stand. For believers, this is our daily wardrobe. That's what this is. This is our daily wardrobe. Verse 14, stand therefore, having your loins girded about with truth, and having on the breast plate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. 16. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. Listen to this wardrobe. Verse 17. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Verse 18. praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. See, be caught being dressed up, even when it seems like there's nowhere to go. You ever heard the statement, all dressed up and nowhere to go? You ready? That's what this statement really is saying. You ready. You're ready for what's ever coming. You're not getting ready. You're ready. You're staying ready. And then we have this final, what I call the D clause in this particular chapter, Revelation 16, verse 15. Keeping his garments on, keeping on his garments that he may not go about naked and be seen exposed. Naked and be seen exposed. The one thing we all can relate to is that we all know what fleshly nakedness looks like. But do you know, have you ever thought about what spiritual nakedness looks like? No, I bet you haven't. Spiritual nakedness is being without. Did you hear me? Let me say it again. It's being without. It's being an unbeliever that is not shielded nor protected by Jesus Christ. Let me say it again. Spiritual nakedness is being an unbeliever. Yes. Someone who's been exposed because you're so tied to your flesh. But you're not being protected nor shielded by your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's what Jesus come and do. That's what his blood does. It covers us. It shields us from his Father. So he don't see all of our sin and all of our mess. You need this covering. You need this shield. Come on. You're not that big, bad, and bold. You're not. Judas fell asleep. King David fell asleep. Come on. Moses fell asleep. Noah's sons fell asleep. Adam fell asleep. Before he was put asleep, he fell asleep. Think about that for a moment. I'm telling you, enjoy your life. Don't wait for retirement. You better enjoy your life. You better go and enjoy that vacation. The thief of time will take you. Yeah. It's been lying to us our whole life. Look at how much you work. Social Security and Medicare. Look, 62 and 65 is when you can start pulling that stuff, start using that stuff. Really? You waiting for that? You planning for that? Our system is set up to steal our time. Just look at that. Why couldn't it be 50 or 30? It's 62 and 65. Come on. You're at the tail end of your life if you get that far. Satan has been stealing away your prayer as well. You've allowed him to come in and steal your prayer life. You just get in bed. You just get up and go because you're so busy being busy. You're so busy, watch this, feeling victimized. You're so busy being taken advantage of. You're so busy being vulnerable. You're so busy thinking the worst of yourself. You're just so busy just letting things happen. No, not making things happen. You let things happen. It takes a thief, watcher, to catch a thief. That's why Jesus said he's coming like a thief, not as a thief. He's coming like a thief because he said you should understand what a thief is because you've done some thievery yourself. So you should be able to watch out for me because I'm coming like a thief because you guys can relate to a thief. And so I'm telling you, get ready. Be ready. Be like the watching upon the wall. You ain't got time to be resting. In order to catch a thief, you have to become like a thief. Think like a thief. Study a thief wave. See, you should be studying your enemy's ways. That way you know how to pray for them. You know how to steer clear of them. You ain't got time. The devil has studied you and your children more than you've ever thought of studying him. Because see, he's looking to steal something from you. He wants to steal their time. See, he's distracting them with fighting you. He's distracting you with fighting them. And here we are with all this stuff, drugs and alcohol and sex and all this money and depression and sickness and pain and body counts and trying to be on board of directors. And yeah, we're going to all these children programs and events. We got terms for it. Soccer moms. We got all these workshops and seminars and conferences, all this stuff we're going to. And then we come home and watch all this celebrity stuff on TV, reality TV, all this stuff, social media, playing all these video games. We are so distracted. We allow the devil to steal our time. Don't get caught up. Don't get caught with your pants down or your skirts up. I'm telling you, you don't know when he's coming. He's coming like a thief. He's told us very well. Some of you, though, need to get caught right now. Whatever you're doing, you need to get caught. See, David needs to get caught with Bathsheba. He needed to. So he could turn his life around. So he could go into being a prayer warrior. To becoming a man after God's own heart. We need to get caught, all of us, so that we can change. Because if we don't get caught, let me tell you something. Boy, we'll keep doing the same thing. You think you're clever. They ain't caught me yet. No, Satan is protecting you because he want to keep you. You want to get caught. I don't care what nobody says. You want to stop. You want to repent. You want to change. And the time is now. Follow the instructions. Yes. Read all the instructions. Because your life every day is like a pop quiz. And you're taking a test. And many of you have failed. You're in the classroom right now. You don't even leave the classroom because you haven't read all the instructions. Isn't it something? You're still reading the test trying to figure it out. Stop being a thief of your own time. That's what I'm trying to say. You've sold your life into this nothingness, if you will. That's what you've done, into your flesh. You've purchased things with your flesh. And here God has a ticket for you to be with him. And you found a ticket that you bought into for eternal damnation. Let me say it again. Stop being the thief of your own time. Stop blaming everybody around you. Repent. Yes. The time is now. Your time is too valuable. Your family's time is too valuable. Stop wasting it. Stop wasting it on you and your selfish ways. Talking about you wish Jesus would come back. You better get yourself ready. You're the one who needs the time. It takes a thief to catch a thief. You be blessed. And don't forget Romans 10 and 9. Confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord. And believe in your heart that God is raised him from the dead, and you too shall be saved. God is God. He's not a thief, but he's coming like one. And I just pray you're ready with your security system, with your covenant, with the blood covenant all around you to shield you from the thievery of the enemy. Let God break in and catch you up, yeah, rapture you up with him when he comes. As he rise the dead first in Christ, and then we too shall rise. You be blessed. Have a great week.